It was in 1949. China's economy isolated when the communists took over under Mao Zedong. Late 1970s, Deng Xiaoping took power. Deng Xiaoping reforms made the system more responsive to demand and supply, and improved efficiency by, among other things, providing production incentives. This led to the creation of a number of various types of privately held enterprises within the services sector as well as the light manufacturing sectors. China grew at a rapid pace as a result of these reforms and opened its economy to the world for trade and foreign direct investment.
2001, China became the member of the World Trade Organization. Membership would grant it coveted status as a member of the world community. Membership would also allow China to participate in and impede negotiations that aimed at opening other markets. It opened up more to the rest of the world, and it is trade with Japan and Asian nations increased rapidly. That's why China had been the second largest recipient to FDI worldwide, to over $53 billion in 2003. And by the end of 2004, actual utilized overseas FDI amounting to $1,096 billion.
Economic growth of the country can be seen from country's GDP and gross domestic product. GDP are influenced by several factors, specifically are personal consumption, expenditures, gross investment and government consumption, local and foreign investment or FDI. And the last is net export of the country. China's real GDP growth from 1980 to 2003 shows significant growth with average at 9.5% per year, with the highest growth peak in 1992 at 14.2% and fell to 7.1% in 1999. Then in 2003, China's GDP reached to $1.4 trillion, and then continue improve through until 2010. It made China as world's second largest economy in estimate using FDI copy. But the hype of the real GDP doesn't mean the prosperity of the country. You can see the prosperity of the country with the per capita income parameter. In 2003, per capita income of China reached to 4,999.95 and growing fast until 2010. At that condition, of about hundreds of million people in China lived out from poverty. According to China experts, the surging of FDI had broke in the much needed capital, technology, expertise, service capabilities, and access to world markets. It was expected that China would continue to need this input for a significant period of time.
China's politic economy. As we know, China is a communist country. Their government strict control over most aspects of the Chinese people's lives. Therefore, the political power is foundation of the economic power. Government create the policy and benefit to foreign to invest, such as administrative support, tax, and subsidies. Negative impact. The negative impact of the communist government that the direction of China will depend on complex political and economical uncertainties. That's why many foreign communists succeed in China because they close to the Communist Party.
For the matter, China has strategic location for trading between Asia and Europe. Chinese consumer and industrial market are growing rapidly. The domestic demand will increase, along with the consumption of the people. As we know, China is the most growth population in the world. That is why China becoming a potential market for investor.
China has a huge labor market because a number of its citizens, fueled by low labor costs and flexible labor practice, are the advantages for companies to invest. On the other hand, China's people who have good education prefer to work overseas. Most of the companies who invest apply and low manufacturing companies. They employ people who are unskilled, so it saves companies cost. Many people have low education, so they not complain about low wage because they need money.
In technological view, there are two parameters that affect the technical economic growth. The first one is they have a fast adopt and customize for the internationalization of R&D, and then they have a flexibility of competitiveness. Second one is they have the for the long term purpose. The first one is from the educational, and then the second one is from the R&D through innovation. They build their own innovation center in their own country to develop the global economic market.
What can we learn from the FDI in China is that first growth engine, China is becoming an Asian economic powerhouse. It attracts lots of countries to invest in their country and also becoming an export-oriented for China itself. And then the second one is the vacuum cleaner. The other country in the region is really afraid that their investment potential will be restricted to China. And the last one is very interesting also. It's about their currency, renminbi, or people say yuan. The government chose not to devaluate the renminbi and chose to use US dollar as international trade currency. It successfully gained the international trust. Matter of fact, when renminbi doesn't flow, so the government is able to devaluate, but the cost of the devaluation will become a revaluation problem as the global issue.
China has to invest in technology development by grow more innovative firms. Also to invest in knowledge and education by build highly competitive system and schools. Try to develop other industry besides manufacturing to attract more foreign direct investment.
Satu, dua, and action.
1,096 billion. Hah? Hah? Sini, kelihatan macam
action. Kan kurang keras suaranya. One action. Satu, dua, action.
China has a
action. Member, action.
So,
one, take, and action.